I'd like to welcome you all to the distinguished speakers of sponsored by the Association for Senior and Emeritus Faculty of the Perelman School of Medicine. And I'm really honored to be able to introduce Dr. Harvey Rubin. Sure. I won't start over again. Dr. Rubin is Professor of Medicine with a secondary appointment in the Computer and Information Sciences. He obtained his PhD at Penn and did his medical training at Columbia and then came back to Penn, I think it was in 1983, where as Professor of Medicine, he also held positions as Associate Dean for Student Affairs and Associate Dean for Research. He is an infectious disease specialist with an expert in the pathophysiology of tuberculosis and has done some really neat mathematical modeling to examine the constant changing states of bacteria as they adapt to the environment. What's not mentioned in his CV is really the fascinating work that he's been doing for about the past almost decade. He was founder and director of Penn's Institute for Strategic Threat Analysis and Response, ISTAR, which is an institute that was set up to advise the public, world leaders, elected officials about threats and with an emphasis on global health. And he's obviously very aware, both from his, obviously from his clinical work, of the difficulty of vaccinating populations in the third world and of the enormous deaths that have occurred because of this. And so about 9 years ago, he had this real novel idea of what to do about it. And he found a nonprofit organization called Energize the Chain with the goal of eradicating vaccination preventable deaths. And I believe that that's what he's going to be talking to us about today. Dr. Rubin?
Thank you, Joel. Thanks to all these old friends. The best part about this is seeing all these old friends. So thanks very much. I am going to talk about our work on Energize the Chain. Just to sort of remind you that this is, as Joel said, something that I don't really do in a professional way. My day job is to do basic biochemistry with my colleagues like Norm Schechter, who's sitting over there, taking care of infectious disease patients. And for this group especially, many, many committees, COAP, the Faculty Senate, and this is a great cartoon from the New Yorker. Whew, that was close, we almost decided something. with all that other stuff going on, here's another cartoon from the New Yorker. And there's a fish climbing out of the swamp. Why don't you just stay and work on being a better fish? So when I was chair of COAP, that was the major advice we would give to junior faculty. Just do what you're doing, become a better associate professor, you'll get promoted, assistant professor, you'll get tenure. Be a better fish. Well, then you just stay in the swamp, becoming a better fish. And it really also reminds me that a great book, Born to Run, where Christopher McDougall said, you don't stop running because you get old because you stop running, right? So you know that. And this is in the book, and my kids tell me that just about every day. So the question is, you gotta keep moving. And this is a great audience to really drive that message home. So where are we going? I'm not gonna talk about basic biochemistry. I'm not gonna talk about the latest developments in treating tuberculosis. I am gonna talk about a huge, huge problem. And that's the problem of kids dying of vaccine-preventable diseases around the world. Arguably, 3, 4, 5 million kids die every year of a disease that's easily preventable if they just get a vaccine. The problem is, why do they die? We have vaccines. And the Gates Foundation sort of coined this phrase, the fifth child, because 1 in 5 kids don't get adequate vaccination around the world. And part of the problem, a main part of the problem, is that you've got to keep vaccines cold. So here's a little vial of a vaccine that I stole from my clinic a couple days ago, and it's been in my pocket for the past few days. I think I ran along the Wissahickon with it. It was 98 degrees or so. This vaccine is totally useless now. It's heated up. If it was frozen and thawed, it also would be useless. Vaccines have to be kept between 2 and 8 degrees. And look at these numbers. The numbers are outrageous. This is already an old slide, but you know, 200,000 deaths from Haemophilus influenza, 200,000 deaths from pertussis, whooping cough, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of deaths from measles, tetanus, pneumococcus, rotavirus, and all the new vaccines that we have. So when you add it up, these are just the deaths, not even preventing the illness that the vaccine could actually prevent. So the numbers are enormous. And the major reason is that there's frequent, who's here traveled overseas? Is there any grid? Do you have a refrigerator out in the remote parts of the world? Not really. So how do you keep vaccines cold? And so the vaccine cold chain works at the vaccine manufacturer. It comes out of Merck downtown. It goes to the major national airport. It's kept nice and cold. The minute you start going more and more distal in the cold chain actually evaporates. And you really, once you get out into the health centers and the health posts, there's no grid power and there's virtually no way to keep vaccines cold. And all along the way, by the way, that counterfeit medicines and counterfeit vaccines enter into this cold chain, which is a $1 billion industry. And so the fact is that not only are they be kept cold, they're not kept cold, they're also counterfeit stuff entering into that chain. And we've been thinking about how to use blockchain technology to track and trace that and actually prevent some of the counterfeiting, but we'll talk about that later. So this is not just, you know, Harvey Rubin's craziness. These are pictures from the World Health Organization. This is how vaccines are unpacked and stored in shipping containers at national levels in low and middle income countries. You gotta believe that that's not kept adequately cold. Even if these were cold boxes, after a week like that, they're not cold anymore. Here are some astonishing numbers. Functional cold chain with optimal technology, 2% in the low and middle income countries when you go out really distally. Non-functional cold chain equipment, refrigerators, 14%. Or poorly performing cold chain equipment, the refrigerator works, doesn't work, 41%. And functional cold chain with outdated technology, huge numbers. But overall, 2 to 5% are actually working. That's why these kids are dying and getting sick, because the vaccines are not kept adequately cold. Not only that, it's just the health and well-being of kids. These are just a smattering of articles that come out frequently. The economic impact of vaccinating kids is enormous. You keep a kid healthy, the health system is more robust, the kid stays in school, mom, and mostly this is a women's issue because who brings junior to the clinic? It's almost always mom. So you're empowering women to stay in and stay in their workplace or stay in their home doing other things. The economic impact is enormous, in literally in the billions of dollars, if you just keep kids vaccinated. So the logical proposition is easy. If vaccinating kids is so important and keeping vaccines at the appropriate temperature is so important, just plug the refrigerator into the wall and get going. See, that's actually not an American outlet. That's a European outlet. It's very true to life. So, right? Easy, easy solution, but not so fast because there is energy poverty that is rampant around the world. There are no outlets to plug the darn refrigerator into. This is that famous night sky picture, this picture from outer space, showing where you want to be. There's virtually no electricity where you need to be. 3.5 billion people lack proper access to electricity. Now, we can't solve the energy poverty problem, but we can solve one small part of that energy poverty problem, how to keep vaccines cold. Everybody thinks there's no energy in the developing world, but you know what? Actually, that's not true. Who here has a cell phone? You all have cell phones. Who's used their cell phone in remote parts of travel? You all have. If you have a cell phone and you're traveling in Namibia or Niger and it's working, that means there's a cell tower close by. There are more cell phones in the world, actually, than there are toothbrushes. There are more cell phones in the world than there are toilet bowls. And the cell phone industry in the developing world is growing exponentially. Nobody has a nobody has a landline in low and middle income countries anymore. So the smart insight that we actually had a couple years ago was that there's plenty of electricity in the developing world. It's in the private sector where the cell towers are. And so what did we do? We solved the problem. We said there is energy in the developing world. Just plug the darn refrigerator into the cell tower and you've solved the problem. So like any good academic, when you solve a problem, you don't really solve the problem. You write a paper claiming that you solved the problem. And so my student at the time, Alice Conant, who you will recognize the name, Emily Conant. Alice is now, she was an undergraduate when we wrote this paper. Alice is now a first year medical student at Penn after getting her master's in public health from Yale. So Alice and I wrote this paper in The New Scientist, thanks to Warren Gefter's daughter, but that's another story, who was an editor at The New Scientist at the time. I think we got it in on the merits though, but thank you. And we just said, and here's the picture that the artist at The New Scientist drew. Here's a guy, you know, it's not me because there's no mustache and no bow tie. Just plug the refrigerator into the cell tower. And basically, this is what it looks like. The refrigerator is right at the cell tower. So we wrote this paper in what it was like 2010 or so, and no pun intended, it went viral. We got invited all over the world to give this talk. One of them happened to be in Mombasa in Kenya, where we ran away to go see Mombasa. And there were engineers in the audience. This was at a cell tower meeting. And one of the engineers came up to me and said, we're going to do this in Zimbabwe. I said, sure, sure. And it turns out that it actually happened. And I'll show you how that happened. We just said that if you put the refrigerators at the cell towers, it's financially and environmentally sustainable because the cell tower industry is growing like wildfire. It's scalable, again, because the cell tower companies, the private sector, is putting cell towers everywhere. And you can turn it over to local managers. So it really fit everything that a private-public partnership should have. And so we also tried to make the case that, in fact, if you can reduce the number of diseases that are prevented by vaccines, you have a tremendous both primary and secondary effect. Obviously, you reduce the morbidity and mortality from these diseases. You expand the delivery of effective vaccines. You expand distribution. You reduce vaccine wastage, which is a big, big problem in low and middle income countries. You improve primary care infrastructure, because now the healthcare workers who were schlepping these cold boxes around can now spend time doing, you know, maternal counseling or HIV work, and they can really now focus on things they should be doing. And it obviously improves access to preventive healthcare. But it also, and this is again from the World Health Organization, I love these last two, it enhances equity and promotes peace. and you know, we all want to believe we do that, but here's a publication that says actually we can do it. And the role that our partners gain from this is people say, well, why in the world would the private sector even want to do this, right? It's not in their business model. Well, it turns out that when you talk to the engineers, security at the tower actually goes up because the elders in the village tell the young kids who are going to go steal the copper and the diesel, if you go near that cell tower that's storing vaccines, you're in big trouble. So the security at the cell tower actually goes up. There's increased brand recognition. The companies now say, we're the cell tower company that's protecting your kids. There's an enormous amount of positive community feelings, and something that we actually learned after the fact, these cell tower companies now go to the government and say, by the way, we need this plot of land to build our new tower. We need a broader, you know, spectrum. Oh, and by the way, look what we're doing for the community. So it really, you know, it's to their benefit to do that. And of course, it meets their corporate social responsibility. We talked about the positive effect on the community, healthier kids, and the effect on the healthcare system. And some of those earlier papers that I showed you really address how effective this is in terms of enhancing the healthcare system in low and middle income countries. And so we share risks, we share resources, governance is shared in any good public-private partnership, and you can actually build capacity, and I'll talk about that a little more in a bit. 1 minute video. Can you hear this?
Life was not always like this. We were losing a lot of babies. A simple vaccine was all that was needed to save their young lives. But the vaccines needed to be kept cold, from 2 to 8 degrees Celsius, against our African heat. We had to throw away lots of these, and it was such a challenge. Then Econet, through its Energize the Chain program, installed close proximity refrigerated containers. These simply use the excess power from the wireless base stations. Now, we don't have to worry about that anymore.
By creating innovative solutions, Econet Wireless is promoting community transformation and joins the fight against the top 5 child killer diseases. Econet Wireless, inspired to change your world.
I gotta tell you, I've seen this video 1,000 times and it still chokes me up a little bit. This was made by Econet, our private sector partner in Zimbabwe. And this is what they do. They put this out. A friend of mine from South Africa sent me this. I didn't even know it was out there. And there's an even longer one. If you Google it, there's a 5-minute one about the role of Econet. Econet is run by a fellow named Strive Misiawa. And Strive is maybe one of the greatest philanthropists in the world, and certainly in Africa. He's a multi-billionaire. Talk to any student from Zimbabwe in this university or anywhere, they will know Strive's name because he's the guy that paid for their high school. He's the guy that's paid for their college education. He's the guy that took care of their cholera epidemic when they're in Zimbabwe. And I just spoke to his folks, and they're now taking care of the cyclone that just hit that part of Africa. So Strive actually sent that engineer to Mombasa, Bernard Fernandez, and that's when Bernard came up and said, Strive wants to do this. How he knew about us, I don't know, but he's on the board of the Rockefeller Foundation, and he's just an amazing, amazing man. He also runs all the currency in Zimbabwe at this point, so that's another story. So Strive sent Bernard, his chief engineer. We gave that talk in Mombasa, maybe 2011 or something like that, 2012. Within a year or two, they had built 100 sites in Zimbabwe. Within a few years after that, we now have 300 sites in Zimbabwe, and we've given out over 500,000 vaccines. Now, that's great news because it's working. The bad news is that as an academic, we never really got to do the baseline assessment, say what's there now and how does our innovation actually change that. But that's ongoing. And again, the problems in Zimbabwe are making that challenging. But that's the kind of effect that we actually can have. We've been at this for a while, as Joel said. A few years ago, we were anointed as a Gavi pace setter. Gavi is the Global Alliance for Vaccines Initiative, which is started off by the Gates Foundation. And it's now a multi-billion dollar organization that's funded by the World Health Organization, UNICEF, the World Bank, a lot of sovereign states, the US, France, Germany, the Great Britain, individual donors. Bill himself actually was instrumental in starting Gavi. It's located in Geneva. And several years ago, they had a meeting of people interested in crazy new ideas about vaccines and how to make them more available. They had a competition. They invited a bunch of people to Geneva, where we competed against each other in a very crazy sort of thing. And out of the 17 that were invited, 7 were anointed as the initial infused partners, and we were lucky to be one of them. And then last year, after all of that, we finally signed an MOU with Gavi, so now we're actually funded by Gavi. It's $500,000 to do a 3-year project in Zimbabwe and Myanmar to do baseline assessments and then a health and social and economic impact of Energize the Chain. The really wonderful thing about the MOU with Gavi is that they committed another $500,000 if we can raise $500,000. So they committed matching funds. And I will be circulating with little can, like the, and any denomination is more than welcome. But so they've committed $1 million if we can raise another half. So it's really been great. And when you go into a country and you say we're here at the behest of Gavi or the Gates Foundation, a lot of doors open up, and they're connected throughout the world. So when we go into a new country, frequently the introductions are made by folks associated with or who work directly with Gavi. So they've been really great. And so this is a classic public-private partnership. Now, if you would have asked me 5 years ago, what is a public-private partnership, I would have no frigging idea what you were talking about. We were worried about, two-side ping-pong mechanisms. But in fact, just a couple of weeks ago, there was a very, very nice perspective published in the New England Journal of Medicine, Public-Private Partnerships in Global Health, Driving Health Improvements Without Compromising Values. So you can imagine what the pushes and pulls are when you're trying to do a public-private partnership. And these guys actually suggested a few metrics. the private sector partner is free of all active allegations of serious unethical, illegal, or deceptive activities. That's the private sector. It's counterproductive for the public health agencies to partner with private sectors whose products or services operate in direct opposition to public health goals. And you can probably think of private sectors that meet some of those criteria. Public health organizations consider whether the benefits of the partnership clearly outweigh the costs. And so that's what I talked about in terms of sharing governance and sharing responsibilities. And I think the folks that we work with, the cell tower industry, fits the criteria of being an okay private sector partner. They don't carry this kind of baggage. When we first got into this, there was some concern, don't you know that cell towers cause breast cancer? I said, I know cell towers do not cause breast cancer. But in fact, some of the hurdles that we came across in writing these MOUs with the private sector was the liability. So the private sector is very, very cognizant of potential liabilities. And in particular, what if this vaccine is now exposed to cell tower radiation? Well, many of you are protein chemists. You really got to do something very special to denature this protein in here using energy from a cell tower. But there is that notion out there. And so the liability that these private sectors confront was a major hurdle. People always say, well, this seems like a no-brainer. Why doesn't everybody do it? When you get right down to it, when the lawyers, no offense to my prosecutor wife sitting in the audience, when the lawyers get involved, they're very, very careful about what they want to get involved with. And what's not mentioned in this article is that the other side of the coin, this is a whole thing about, is the private sector an okay company, an okay entity to work with? But we're in Myanmar, we're in Zimbabwe, and there's very little discussion about the other side of the coin. What is my responsibility to work in Myanmar, where there's enormous amounts of human rights abrogations in that particular country? And I am reminded all the time about our responsibility to do the right thing when you're working in these countries. Is it okay to write an MOU with the Ministry of Health in a country that's oppressing the Rohingya population? And I would love to get your thoughts on this. It does plague me. We talk about this a lot at home. So there are two sides to this coin. Everybody thinks, oh, the private sector are the bad guys. Well, sometimes the public sector is not particularly good guys either. So this is an issue that keeps coming up, and I don't know the answer to that question. We have a bunch of ethicists and deep thinkers in the audience, and I would really love to get your thoughts on that. And so where are we after all of this? Well, as I said, in Zimbabwe, we're literally all over the country, over 300 sites. In Ghana, and my friend Oseng Eke is in the audience here, who, by the way, his students just won the President's Engagement Prize. So congratulations to Oseng. We've been in Ghana. We have proposed three sites in the Upper West, Upper East, and the Volta Lake District. We have been working in Ghana now for years. The initial hurdle was the private sector. They were very worried, and it's an American company. The tower company is called American Tower, based in Boston. Their initial reluctance was this liability issue. What if somebody gets measles after they got a vaccine that was stored at our cell tower site? Are they going to come and say, you screwed up somehow? You know, we had a long time trying to explain to them that no vaccine is perfect, et cetera, et cetera. And they finally got over that. They wanted to be held, you know, no harm and all that. Now it's been such a long time, it's back to the cell tower operator, MTN, which is one of the operators in Ghana. And they're rethinking it. We should hear back any day now if they're going to fund this. And I think things look good. And that'll be 30 sites in Ghana. We are up and running in, of all places, Myanmar. This is an MOU we signed a couple of months ago. We're down in this region. I'll show you more pictures in a minute. We have 5 pilot sites that are finished and with another 50 ready to go. And a few months ago, I was in Guinea-Conakry to roll it out in Guinea at the invitation of the CDC and the International Organization for Migrants. So this is up and running. Wherever we go, we try and make relationships with universities, because remember one of the slides I showed you was capacity building. So in Ghana, we have a terrific relationship with Kwame Nkrumah University. And the idea there is to help train health impact analysis and public health issues in these various countries, using, in our case, Gavi funds to actually support these people. Alice, by the way, Alice Conant and a colleague of hers from Yale will be going to Myanmar this summer to initiate the health impact analysis. So people say, how do you do this? Well, first thing, we identify our partners. Sometimes the partner is the cell tower. They call us and they say, can you do this in our area? Sometimes it's a university, like in Nigeria. Our OSEC is actually from Nigeria. He's introduced me to the School of Public Health in Nigeria. That's being initiated by the university. Sometimes it's another multinational organization. In Guinea, it was the CDC and the United Nations. So we will be very flexible on how we enter a particular country. Yesterday, I had a talk with USAID. They asked, can we do it in Niger? I said, sure, with your introductions, let's do it. So we identify all of our partners. And then we have a process. We know how to do this. We always go to the Minister of Health first and say, where are we needed? You know, we're not needed in Yangon. We're not needed in Accra. We're not needed in Nairobi. We're not needed in Lagos, because pretty much that's on the grid. But where the Ministry of Health says, you need to be up here in Upper West because there ain't nothing up there, then we go there. And what we do is we talk to the cell tower companies. This is all GIS mapped. They know exactly where their towers are, literally down to the inch. And we know exactly how close they are to the various clinics. So we do a GIS mapping of the overlap between the cell towers and the clinics. And we say, we can help you here. And then we start building the facility and turn it over to the local healthcare workers. So we do a site assessment. It starts getting built. We set it up. Now, the refrigerator is generally procured through UNICEF. So we're not spending a penny to buy refrigerators. We're not spending a penny to buy vaccines. What we're spending our time and money on is doing the organization and making sure everybody is talking to each other and we're all on the same page. And then we can actually hand it over. And this is a site in Zimbabwe. There's the base station. Here's some clean energy associated with it. And in this particular case, the vaccine shelter is actually within the perimeter of the cell tower. I'll show you other pictures where we have different kinds of setups. So in Zimbabwe, we're here in Angwa, which is right on the river. It's very, very remote. It's way up here in the northern part of Zimbabwe. This is a picture that actually Alice took when she was there a few years ago. This is the Angwa catchment area. This is the Angwa River. And this is the area that we serve. And this is data. This is data in low and middle income countries. This is how they keep their data. Here's a DPT book. We have one for BCG and MMR, all of the different vaccines. And this is what it looks like. They put up vaccine shelter brought to you by Econet, and we have our Energize the Chain. And here are the local managers. So this is actually working in a very remote part of, a very, very remote part of Zimbabwe. Here's the capital of Zim somewhere. I can't see it. It's actually right on the Zambezi National Park. I haven't been there yet, but we got to go. We're up and running in Myanmar. This is my colleague Staffan Quist, who's actually had a great op-ed piece in the Sunday Times about nuclear energy. You should read it. He's an energy consultant, and he found me somewhere. We met in Holland a few years ago, and he said, I want to help you. We're all volunteers, by the way. There's don't tell the deans, there's not a penny that gets paid to me in this endeavor. So Staffan, we paid for Staffan to go to Myanmar. We had been at a conference in Singapore at a mobile phone conference, and they said, we want to do it in Myanmar, of all places. So this is the Rakhine district. This is where all of the disruption that you've heard about. Right over here is Bangladesh. So a lot of the refugees are leaving here and going over into Bangladesh. There's another region up here, Kachin, where the government basically ignores everybody. But the cell tower company called Edotco have an enormous number of towers up there. And they, believe it or not, here's a really interesting example, they want to do something good for the people up here. They said, can you come to Kachin? We said, absolutely. Right now, all of our work is down here near Yangon, which is the capital, and Irrawaddy. And so what does it look like there? We've selected 5 pilot sites. They're up and running. Edotco will supply the FOC, free of charge. The amount of energy it takes to run a refrigerator is about 100 watts. It's like maybe 60 cents a day. It is nothing. It's nothing. It doesn't cost them. It's less than a rounding error for these major telecom companies. So they are actually donating all the electricity. The site's not only what this is a bit, you know, this is a couple of weeks old, ready for handover to the Ministry of Health. And this is where we are in Arawadi, along, happens to be along a river as well. Very, very remote. The trucks, the boats don't get there, especially in the rainy season. We're coming up to the rainy season in Myanmar right now. This river will be out to here during the rainy season. And so this is what it looks like. Now here, you remember in Zim, we built the shelters inside the perimeter of the cell tower. In this case, they just ran the wire underground into the cell tower power supply, and the shelter is outside. It's okay with us. Whatever they want to do with that particular region, if they think the security is good enough, we're very flexible. One thing we learned is that you don't go to these countries and say, do it my way, because nothing will get done if you do that. This is what goes inside. These are not just the run-of-the-mill refrigerator you buy at Best Buy. These are World Health Organization certified refrigerators. Some of them are actually so-called solar direct drive, but these are not. These are much more less expensive than solar direct drive. These are the refrigerators. We know exactly how many, what kind of voltage it takes and the capacity. So some are smaller, some are bigger. It depends on that catchment area that we're trying to serve. This is what goes into each one of our shelters. Not only that, we met this company called Nextleaf, which is a company that a couple of women actually from Stanford developed. It's a remote monitoring system. And every one of our refrigerators are fitted out with a Nextleaf so-called cold trace temperature monitor. So what goes in those refrigerators are constantly monitored through the cell tower. So if the temperature fluctuates too much or the door is left open, a text message is sent to the, an SMS message is sent to the local healthcare worker, go close the door, go see what's going on in the temperature. And so people say, what does the Ministry of Health get out of this? Well, they get more kids vaccinated. We offload the cost of powering up the refrigerator. But we provide, in this day and age, this is gold for the Ministry of Health. We provide enormous amounts of data for the Ministry of Health through our wireless connection that is now fed into a huge data bank that lives up in the cloud, and we're beginning to collect this kind of data, and we can analyze wastage and how many times the door is open. Hopefully we'll make the life of the healthcare worker that much more efficient. And this was the handover in Myanmar. This happened literally a couple of weeks ago. So thank you for postponing the talk until the spring. These are the regional healthcare workers in Myanmar. These are the folks from the company called the Dotco. And we've hired now two people on the ground full-time in Myanmar to be the project managers. And this was a meeting held in the Ministry of Health and attended by all the interested parties. And you can see the healthcare workers here. And this is what the shelter looks like. And it was just unfortunately I wasn't there, but Staffan took these pictures, and it's been a huge success in Myanmar. And they really want us to go up way up into the northeastern part of the country now, which is really, really exciting and an amazing opportunity. So that's Myanmar. A couple months ago I was in Guinea, again invited by the CDC and the International Organization of Migration. This bracelet is something the CDC designed and put together commemorating the Ebola outbreak in 2014-2016. And that was an enormously impactful episode for everybody in that part of Africa. These are the healthcare workers that I met with at the UN organization. This is the capital. You fly into Conakry. And then we drove to Cancan, which is in the most, you know, sort of eastern part of the country. Cancan is about 12 hours away by car over roads that you can't even, makes Forbidden Drive look like a five-lane highway. And it's about 4 hours through these one-lane pathways that flood. When a truck falls over, everything stops. It was an amazing trip. And this is where we are scouting out our first sites in Guinea. This is what the capital looks like. It's just a spectacularly beautiful country. It's right on the coastline. It could be an enormously wealthy country. They have more bauxite, which makes aluminum, than any other country in the world. But unemployment is in the 60% range, and it's just another almost failed state. But it's quite beautiful, and they do care about their kids. And when we were there, happens to be on Orphans Day, and so we thought that was actually a pretty interesting, you know, sort of confluence of ideas. So we jumped in our car. Here's our fearless driver, Pepe. Luckily, we were in a UN car, so we got to go ahead of other people in various lines. This guy is a genius driver. It was an overturned truck. He pulled off the road, literally went through these roads, through these little huts, and he got us around the overturned truck. Fearless. The guy is fearless. I was, you know, white-knuckled. But this is sunrise. This is sunrise. So we left the capital at about 5 in the morning to make that long trip, and this is sunrise over the prairies in Guinea. Absolutely beautiful. And everywhere you go, you see cell towers, everywhere. We finally got to Cancan, and this is the waiting room in the emergency department at Cancan. So if there's any emergency room doctors now, don't feel bad, because this is what the emergency room looks like in a very remote part of Guinea. This is where we stayed in they fondly call it a hotel. It was not exactly a hotel. But they had a very nice mosquito net and various things on the floor that were quite large and quite fearful. And this is what the hospital complex looked like. So we met with a lot of the doctors there, and we had a great couple of days out in Cancan. Very, very remote and really amazing. And I asked the guy who actually ran the medical service, I said, what is your major problem? And I thought he would say tuberculosis and malaria. Do you know what he said? He actually said obstetric complications of clitoral removal. So that is the level of care that we see in this part of the world. So it wasn't something in my world that I thought he would clearly say, you know, measles, pneumonia, malaria. It was obstetric complications. And so, and that brought up the whole issue of, can they operate under these conditions? You know, you don't see too many things getting plugged in, even in a relatively large city like Cancan. They don't have continuous power. And so the discussion quickly goes from, can you use cell tower energy not only to keep vaccines cold, but can you power up my operating room? And you know, that's a fraught question, because I don't want to put that kind of burden on the cell tower companies. They'll say, okay, 60 cents a day to run a refrigerator, but now if you're asking me to start powering up, you know, operating rooms, that's another whole story. But that conversation is what actually happened yesterday with USAID in Niger. They want to build microgrids around cell towers for this very reason of in some small way, combating that energy poverty problem, because you can't do an emergency operation in the middle of the night if you can't see. And so it's a new wrinkle, and it's an ongoing conversation. And it was really brought home to me by these women. And so here we are talking. This guy runs the health service. He is a very scary guy. When he says do something, everybody else in the room does it. These people are completely 100% devoted to their profession and to the people in their village. It's really, it's really remarkable. And he was showing me that he has a Gavi refrigerator, in fact. And this is the kind of thing that would go into our shelters. It was just that it was a fantastic experience. And so, again, the whole issue is like, why do this? How can you convince the private sector and the public sector to work together? As I said, in Guinea, it has enormous possibilities, extensive natural resources, bauxite, gold, diamonds, uranium, offshore oil, has tremendous hydroelectric power and two huge dams, mostly built by the Chinese. There are multinational corporations there that are mining this somewhat to the detriment of the people who actually live in Guinea. But there are bilateral diplomatic relationships, and it's a very, very young population. It's an extraordinarily young population, but half of those under 30 are unemployed. Even kids who go to colleges, there are virtually no jobs. The GDP is less than $7 billion a year. The Gavi budget is $10 billion a year. So the GDP is really suffering. And there's an ongoing attack on the healthcare infrastructure in Guinea. Ebola, obstetric issues, malaria, and others. And so what we really have to do is think about developing, even in the bigger sense, these economic models that involve public-private partnerships with multinational participation. And you can actually make a dent in some of these sustainable development goals using this model of energize the chain public-private partnerships. As I said, the countries that need us most have many, many issues. So in Zimbabwe, if you've been following the politics, Mugabe was this 80, 90-year-old guy who ran the country for decades. He was finally ousted in essentially what was a military coup. And our program was running very smoothly in Zimbabwe until Mugabe got kicked out. And we had already turned over, Energize the Chain and Econet had turned over the whole system to the Ministry of Health. Well, with Mugabe gone and all of his people gone, there was virtually nobody running the program anymore. And so I was just on the phone with them a couple days ago. It's now reverted back to Econet, the cell tower company. And that engineer, Bernard Fernandez, who we met in Mombasa many years ago, has now taken control over it. I was going to send Alice and Rose to Zim to do the analysis, but Bernard said, give me a few months to really rebuild the system. So, you know, it was working great. This is what happens. And things that are not, you know, high up on their list of important things to worry about gets forgotten. So we're rebuilding in Zimbabwe. Not only that, that cyclone that hit a couple of weeks ago in Mozambique, Malawi, and Zimbabwe decimated parts of the country where we are. And so, you know, what can you do? I mean, if the cyclone takes out the cell tower, you're finished. So, you know, between natural disasters and human disasters, working in these countries is very, very hard. I don't have to tell you about what the situation in Myanmar. This is just in the New York Times a few days ago. Red Cross volunteers assisting a girl wounded during the fighting between the Myanmar military and Arakan army in the Rakhine state. That's that western part of the country that borders Bangladesh. And this, again, was just April 8th. In the Associated Press, Malaysia says 41 Rohingya land up north, 200 is still at sea. So we have no idea, and there are kids in that, on those boats. So when we talk about, oh, you're ready for, you know, you get a notice from My Penn Medicine, you're ready for your next vaccine. There is no My Penn Medicine sending you a text message, you're ready for your next vaccine. How do you keep track of these refugee kids? Do you start all over again when they show up at a clinic? And it's really, really a serious issue. How do you even know who's ready for the next vaccine? And hey, what's that? I don't know what happened there. Something happened to our. Are you back up in there?
There's a video.
Maybe. No. That's several slides ago. Keep going. Yep. Go ahead. Keep going. Hold the slowdown. Keep going. Yep. Keep going. Oh, all right. Okay. Hold on. So go to this one right here. This countries that need us most. Can you hit that? Nope. Up. We need two up. This. Yeah. And one more, please. Perfect. Okay. So this is. Nope. Okay. I got it now. I hope. So this is the Rohingya story. Maybe you're going to have to run this, sir, because my gizmo is not working. Can you go to the next slide, please? We're frozen. Are you up there? Oh. Okay, perfect. That's perfect. Thank you. So we talked about the issue in Zimbabwe. We talked about the issue in Myanmar. There's also issues in Guinea, of course. The socioeconomic impact, health impact of Ebola was enormous, and including riots at places where the Ebola teams were working. And you can see that the Ebola crisis in Guinea, in West Africa, just almost decimated the country. And in fact, the study showed that in our particular world, 30% decline in childhood vaccination rate, people didn't want to go to the health center because that's where you got Ebola. And so what they were telling me now, there's a tremendous spike in measles. There's a tremendous spike in all these vaccine-preventable diseases because now we're seeing it 2 years later. So the economic impact on the GDP and the health of the country, just because the Ebola crisis is over, it's not over yet. So it's tough, but we continue to win awards. Here's Alice Conant winning an award. This is Bernard. Here's the engineer that did it from Econet. This is an award she won in South Africa. We won an award that was the CSR initiative. So these companies, the private sector, they get to keep these beautiful little things. Put it up on their corporate wall. And this is an award we won in South Africa just about a year ago. So, you know, the world recognizes that something good is happening, but there's still a lot of problems. What's really interesting from an academic point of view is that when you go there, there's all sorts of cool things that we still have to do. So for example, as I mentioned, how do you keep track of millions of kids, lots of refugees? Can you do infant biometrics? By the way, fingerprints and footprints don't work. And even if they, for an under 5-year-old, even if they did, where's the record going to be kept? So now, when we first started this, I had a little collaboration with somebody in the engineering school to do facial recognition. And I'm glad it didn't work because now facial recognition has gotten all this privacy stuff and everybody's already nervous about facial recognition. So I need ideas on how you do infant tracking, because that kid gets off the refugee boat, where is she in her vaccine strategy? How do we even safely and securely query these databases? No idea, even in low and middle income countries. Can we carry out real-time secure inventory tracking? Maybe blockchain is an answer to this, and we've been exploring the use of blockchain technology to safely and securely track and trace the inventory. This is something the Gates Foundation and Ministries of Health really worry about. This is an enormous suck on all of the resources. And finally, last but not least, can we deliver some of these vaccines using autonomous vehicles? That's one of the hangups that MTN Foundation in Ghana, we've been in my TED talk 3 years, 4 years ago, whatever it was, we talked about this. And now all of a sudden MTN says, can you use drones? Here are engineers sitting over there. Of course we can use drones. The GRASP lab is one of the greatest robotics labs in the world. We can easily use drones to deliver these things, especially in the Volta Lake District, where you can't get to with vehicles. So we're really excited about the use of autonomous vehicles to deliver these kinds of vaccines. So I coined the term HITS, High Impact Technology Solutions, Energize the Chain Labs. It exists in my head. It doesn't exist in a building yet. But, you know, again, we'll be carrying the cup around. So I'm really excited about this. If we can ever get this up and running, we have incredibly smart engineering, bioengineering students that would just leap onto this. It would be a great fun thing to do. By the way, I want to recognize, they're the two women who won the President's Engagement Prize, Summer and Princess. Just stand up. Congratulations, ladies. They were in my point of care diagnostics, and we spent time in Ghana together. They are, you got them afterwards, don't talk to me, talk to those two women. They're really fantastic people. But don't play basketball against Princess, because she'll dunk on you. So how are we going to access those matching funds? I was joking about the can. How can we raise $500,000 so that Gavi can give us another $500,000? There is the world of impact bonds that I'm learning about. The beautiful thing about this university is that this is an idea that was brought to me by kids at the Wharton School. I'd given them a talk on this. They had a whole semester project on helping energize the chain, identify novel funding mechanisms. And social impact bonds actually started with the idea of how do you reduce prison recidivism. And the idea was that the municipality doesn't do a very good job. So send it out to a private sector, an NGO, let them work out education programs and all of that, thereby reducing prison recidivism. It'll save the municipality an enormous amount of money. So you issue a bond to fund that NGO or that private sector group that's going to do prison recidivism training. And if you can prove to the municipality that you're saving them money, then the investors will get paid back actually fairly well, even up to 10% on their bond. So our public-private partnership, we met with the guy with kids at Wharton, and these are students. They're just that's what's great about being at Penn. And we started thinking about how to do a social impact bond with Social Finance UK, which is one of the leading social impact bond groups in the world. And it's all about showing how we're going to save money by doing this Energize the Chain project. So that's work in progress. So who are we? I keep saying we. This is it. This is the free serving people. Sam Wertheimer is an old friend of mine who's a venture capitalist, actually did his PhD in malaria research up in New York. Staffan, as you know, he's originally from Sweden, he lives in London. He's an energy guy. He did the whole Myanmar project. Kent is a professor of economics at the Wharton School, maybe one of the smartest guys I know. Denise Winter is a Wharton grad who lives out in California, and she's, again, a volunteer. She keeps my finances in reasonable shape. Alice, you all know, she's a first-year medical student. Oh my God, there's OSEC. The reason I get to travel around Africa safely is because OSEC knows everybody in the border crossings. So thank you, OSEC. And those are the people, but this is really our passion. It's these kids. And I think I consider myself incredibly lucky to be surrounded by amazing faculty, amazing students, and people who really see this as something that we can do. It's not a Penn project. We're Energize the Chain is a 501c3. We don't run a penny through the University of Pennsylvania. Every penny goes without overhead to Energize the Chain. It's because I think we can actually do some good in the world, and that would be a fun legacy that a bunch of us are working on. So thank you for inviting me to give this talk, and it's great to see a bunch of old friends.
I'm sure lots of people have very interesting questions to put forth.
No, that's a myth. No, I asked Vicky said, oh, you could do that. I said, no, none of that FIAP stuff for me. So Paul Liebman is the reason I'm on this side of Spruce Street instead of on the other side. I came to his lab when I was still in the physics in the graduate school. I came to Penn in 1969 as a physics grad student. And I got interested in biomolecular stuff, and he was foolish enough to take me in his lab, and he made me cut out frog eyeballs. I said, I'm never working with animals again. So thank you, Paul.
I do have one question.
Yeah. Well, actually, increasing brand usage did not escape the people in the private sector. So your comment is closer to the truth than you would know. Yes?
Do all vaccines need to be refrigerated? It seems like there must be other ways of preserving them. You know, I know proteins can hold up to, like, SDS when you vaccinate.
Yeah. Right, so we get that question asked a lot. There's a fair amount of work on trying to get thermostable vaccines. In fact, the Gates Foundation is putting a lot of money into that. You can embed them in silk protein and all of that. Even if that were successful today, by the time you do the clinical trial, it's another 10 years. But there are one or two vaccines that you can safely lyophilize and then resuspend, but not many. The holy grail of getting a completely thermostable vaccine is still out there for protein chemists to work on. But I welcome that. If that's it and we're useless, we'll run operating rooms. But yeah, no, that's exactly right. As of now, all but one. I forgot which one is thermostable. Yeah, sure.
Do you have a problem transporting your vaccines to the refrigeration site?
Yeah. So you saw right through to the vulnerability of where we are. Yes, we've talked a lot about taking over the entire cold chain. We're okay remotely. We've partnered with various other groups that can get us to the various sites in a refrigerated fashion, but that is a tremendous issue. It's actually okay. The vaccine doesn't have to be kept cold. I mean, it has a shelf life even, you know, in an ice box. That's okay. So, but you're right. I mean, if it's more than 12, if it's 3 or 4 days, we're in trouble. So, and in places like that, everything moves by truck. Nothing moves by plane, nothing moves by train. It all moves by truck. And so that is a potential vulnerability. You're right.
I'd like to make a comment about working in a country like South Africa under apartheid, where...
Tell the gang why you know about that.
Well, we were born in South Africa. We lived there for 30 years and spent much of our time in black hospitals. There were only black patients under the apartheid regime. And although the boycotts of South Africa eventually helped to bring down The boycott of South Africa eventually helped to bring down apartheid. It also had incalculable effects on the most vulnerable members of the population, i.e. the very people that apartheid was oppressing, the black people and the children. And so as a pediatrician, who used to be a chop, I feel that I can only applaud you for working in these countries, especially a country like Zimbabwe. On the other hand, you could make examples of where do you draw the line and so on, but I don't think we should go there. I think we shouldn't have children as our hostages, as is happening on the southern border of the United States. So I really applaud you, Harvey, for doing this.
Well, thank you. And again, it's a team effort. But hearing stories like yours, it really, again, brings it home. I mean, people who've worked in those regions and have seen the devastation is so important for everybody else to hear. And I'm sure you follow what's going on in South Africa now. The political situation in South Africa now is a mess. In fact, there was just a big article about the energy situation in South Africa. There are brownouts even in Joburg, even in Cape Town. So specifically for our world, the energy problem in South Africa is overwhelming. Yes.
Is there any way of knowing how effective you've been?
Well, that's what we're going to spend the Gavi money doing. So Alice and Rose are going to tell us how we're doing in Myanmar. The minute we start getting back up and running in Zim, we're going to send a team over there. That everybody wants the data. Everybody wants the data. I think we're doing okay. So far, so good. But we need to publish this. You're exactly right. No, you're exactly right. That we got to get the data. Right. Right.
I think it'd be very hard for them to say, can we put
you hit it. You hit it exactly right. So the question was, what else can you put at these sites? It's not just the vaccines. So we do put oxytocin because this notion of postpartum hemorrhage is a big one. We can put oxytocin in the sites. We put snake antivenin in the sites as well. We don't put things like insulin, where you need to go to the refrigerator twice a day, for example, or amoxicillin. So we're very careful about not overstepping what we can do in those. If we don't put, champagne in there either. But so we do put oxytocin vaccines. We can put blood and blood products in an emergency and antivenin. Again, it's a matter of what it would take to do that. The Ministry of Health. We just say, if there's space in the refrigerator, and you saw the example, there is space in those refrigerators. So.
Great.
Thank you.
I wonder if you would say just a little bit more about the parts of the
So those of you who don't know Dr. Risa Lavisa-Morey, that's Risa Lavisa-Morey, who is maybe one of the most renowned public health people, physicians in the country. She was my student at the Brigham, that's why I can say that. So Risa used to run the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and now we're lucky enough to have her as a PIC professor here, and brings an enormous wealth of knowledge in that particular area. And I think you're right, that's why I think this capacity building potential, wherever we go, we try and make a relationship with the universities. So with OSEC's help, we've been UNILAG, University of Lagos, again, Kwame Nkrumah, University in Myanmar. We are very, very interested in building that kind of public health capacity. Not only does it help in that notion of impact analysis, but people will learn about communicable diseases as well. And so I'm really excited about that. And I think the potential to do that is enormous. But we need to put people on the ground in a permanent way. Luckily, that's because of what we do, is that we try and do this. And it's a tremendous opportunity. We need to, maybe I can pick your brain some more and we can figure out how to do that. Yes. Yeah, absolutely, especially in Zimbabwe. We haven't gotten that far in Myanmar yet because we're just literally within the last couple of weeks up and running. But in Zim, that happens all the time. They were instrumental in the cholera outbreak in Zimbabwe, and we do actually use the SMS texting for that very purpose. As I said, it was going great guns until the coup, and that's one of the things we have to rebuild. But again, that's because Strive Masiyawa is completely dedicated to the public health aspects of mass communication. But the ability to use the cell tower not only as an energy source, but as a data source and a data extraction and promotion source is unparalleled. You can't do it on television. It's through the SMS text. So that's a great insight. Yes. Right.
Supply chain, but then that ended up not working because people weren't even using it in the way that was intended. So,
right.
Yes.
In fact, we've heard about the Coca-Cola. Everybody says go talk to Coca-Cola, but you know, as good as they are, they fail as well. So the stability of the private sector is something that, again, that was that notion of that slide on public-private partnerships. We haven't had that issue yet. One of the most stable industries in the low and middle income countries are the cell tower companies. Now, since we started doing this, the industry has changed. It used to be that every mobile phone operator built their own tower. And so you would have a tower that would just have Orange or MTN or Vodafone on it. Over the past 5 or 6 years, the industry has changed. So now there are tower companies. They build the tower and they actually manage the tower and rent space to the various operators. And now there are these things called ESCOs that have evolved, that is energy supply companies. So there's a third component to this whole infrastructure, this whole ecosystem, where the energy companies are supplying energy to the towers. And so the industry is not that it's not stable, but it's in flux. And so who do you talk to is really, and who do you know is your best partner? It turns out that in Ghana, American Tower is our best partner, and MTN, their main renter, is also becoming a very good partner. So you're right. I mean, this is a moving landscape, and we have to keep ahead of it. it's an aspect, again, that I never knew was going to evolve that way. Norman.
Great.
Good question. That's why I collaborated with Norm for the past 30 years. He always asks me the hardest question. So if you go to any of these little villages, you will find in the little marketplace a guy sitting there with a small diesel generator, a kid on a bicycle, and that's the charging station. And sometimes it's run by the local cell tower company, but frequently it's a small business. And a guy buys a little diesel generator, and he charges people whatever it is to charge their cell phones. That's how it's done. And by the way, you can send money through that guy. He does everything. People have the cell phone apps where when I was in Guinea, we would stop periodically so guys could send money back to their family in another part of Guinea. So that's how they keep the cell phones charged. They don't plug it into the wall.
I have a question. How stable is the whole situation? I mean, if something happens to you or something happens to energizing the chain, is it each country that kind of, is there somebody in each country that will keep that country going?
I have a really great pen insurance policy that, yes, you're right. I think if that's that group of the gang of six or seven of us, if we all went away, the project would probably go away. We don't have we're not big enough yet to have that stability. You're absolutely right. I really wish that it would be that way. There's a team in Myanmar, but they're funded by me. There's a team in Zimbabwe funded by Econet. If there's nobody pushing them, it's probably not going to happen. If we weren't in Ghana every summer pushing the people in Ghana, and Osek and I show up at the Ministry of Health and start hounding them, if we didn't show up, nothing would happen. If we didn't get across the border to Nigeria and talk to our colleagues at UNILAD, nothing would happen. So it's a problem. Thank you for that, Joel.
That is an
up and coming. There is solar power, but as I said, in Myanmar, we're heading into the rainy season. None of those solar panel things are going to work during the rainy season in Myanmar. In Guinea, there are a lot of direct drive solar panel refrigerator systems. They're very expensive, and the culture of maintenance is a really important and difficult issue in low and middle income countries. If you ride through the streets of Guinea, all the street lights are powered by solar panels, and one in three work because as red dust gets on it, you got to keep solar panels clean. So maintenance is a huge, huge problem in many of these countries. The beauty about this solution is that maintenance is maintained by the engineers at the cell tower. And it's not maintenance free, but it's much more controlled. Warren. Luckily, I have tenure, so they can go take it. I have a great family. I have a great wife who doesn't, who accompanies me on a lot of these trips, by the way. Great kids, and it's just so much fun. It's not even a job, to be honest. I'm very lucky. I love what I do, it's not even a job. Okay.
Thank you very much, Harvey. This was really good.